Hello, and welcome to today's talk. I'm your host, Mohammed Billoo, and today we will discuss how Torizon by Toradex can help manage IoT and Edge devices, from seamless, secure, and reliable over-the-air updates to remote access and monitoring. Today's webinar is a follow-up to a past webinar where we discuss how Torizon can streamline the embedded software development workflow. We highly recommend everyone to check it out after this webinar to refresh their memories, as the demos that we will be showing today will be follow-ups to the demos from that webinar. We will be providing a link to the webinar in the next slide, just in case. Also, I would like to thank Toradex for their continued support. Not only have they continued to provide hardware to allow me to provide useful demonstrations during these webinars, but they have provided promotional and technical support to ensure that this webinar is successful. We actually have Drew Mosley at this webinar as well. Drew is a technical solutions architect for Toradex in the Tampa Bay area in the US. With a skill set in software engineering and strategic technical leadership, Drew is involved in all phases of development and testing of deliverables. He architects customer-facing solutions in embedded software, embedded Linux, and Internet of Things. Finally, one housekeeping note. If you have any questions during the course of the webinar, feel free to enter them into the chat or Q&A windows, and we will address them during the question and answer session at the end of the webinar. You are also welcome to ask your question during the session at the end. Here we see today's agenda. First, we're going to take a closer look at the motivation behind what we're trying to accomplish. Specifically, we will try to formulate a rough set of requirements when managing in IoT and Edge devices. Then, we will discuss these requirements in more detail and some of the trade-offs that exist, including security and reliability, and how to manage downtime during the over-the-air update process. Then we will discuss why remote access and monitoring is important and some of the challenges that go along when adding such capabilities to Edge and IoT devices. Finally, we will provide an in-depth overview of the Torizon web interface. We will also see some detailed demonstrations that showcase the powerful capabilities of Torizon. Again, I highly recommend everyone to check out the previous webinar linked here after this webinar, since the demos in this webinar are based on the demos that were shown there. First, a little bit about us. I'm Mohammed Billoo, founder of MabLabs Embedded Solutions. MabLabs is a Toradex technology partner. Our expertise is in developing custom IoT and embedded system solutions, ranging from Linux modifications and driver development to support your custom hardware, to application solutions across a multitude of domains and verticals. Remember to check out our website and LinkedIn page. We highly recommend everyone to sign up to our BIOS Food newsletter. Our newsletter helps you stay up to date with news, information regarding upcoming workshops and webinars and courses. We also provide insights and tips and tricks that we learn during the course of our project work that can also be of benefit to you. We also discuss new developments in embedded Linux and the Yocto project. You can sign up for our newsletter by entering the QR code on your phone or by going to our website. Now, let's talk about the motivation behind and the requirements associated with managing Edge and IoT devices. As we all know, firmware and software is continuously being developed. Test engineers are always doing their due diligence in identifying deficiencies and bugs, and customers are requesting additional features in the application. And thus, we need a mechanism to update firmware on devices that are not easily accessible via physical means, or they may be part of a network that is important for critical infrastructure and requires minimal downtime. And thus, we need what is referred to as an OTA update mechanism, or over the air. Specifically, we need a solution that is built on tested and proven open source frameworks. Generally, open source implementations and frameworks are thoroughly tested by the community, and because source code is available, any necessary tweaks and adjustments can be made by ourselves. I actually recall reading an article published by Google wherein they mentioned that open source projects were generally the quickest to resolve CVEs that were identified, even quicker than Google's own frameworks and projects. Additionally, we require a solution that ensures that updates are reliable and secure, that any interruption in the update process doesn't break the device, and that any updates that are installed onto the device are authorized by the manufacturer and/or vendor. Beyond just OTA, we would prefer to have a comprehensive solution that can provide us with key device metrics, including resource utilization. Finally, it would be great if we can get the capability to access the device remotely and securely. This would allow authorized engineers to troubleshoot devices that haven't been deployed into the field and minimize any downtime from an RMA process. One such framework is called Uptane. Uptane was developed as a secure update mechanism for the automotive industry. It is capable of resisting attacks by nation-state level actors, which in the cybersecurity domain are generally the toughest adversaries. Uptane was designed so that security does not degrade all at once. Instead, different levels of access to devices or infrastructure must be gained. Uptane achieves this by making different critical elements of the backend distributed. Uptane can handle the device failures listed here. First, if power to the device is interrupted while an update is ongoing. Second, if an update is buggy and can cause the device to malfunction. Third, if the device is interrupted for any other reason. Fourth, if the device loses network connectivity. Fifth, if the device runs out of storage. Sixth, if the key that is used to sign an image is lost. Seventh, if an authorized update is actually replaced by an unauthorized update. And finally, if the device is never given the opportunity to perform an update because the appropriate conditions have not manifested. These are just some of the failure modes that Uptane can guard against, and we can see how extensive it is. This slide shows some of the attacks that Uptane can thwart when updating a device. On the top left, we have an eavesdrop attack, where an attacker aims to read unencrypted data associated with an update in an attempt to reverse engineer the firmware. In the middle left, we have a drop request attack, where an attacker blocks any ingress or egress network traffic in an attempt to prevent the device from updating. In the bottom left, we have a slow retrieval attack. This causes the device to receive an update so slowly that a known security vulnerability can be exploited by the attacker. On the top right, we have the freeze attack, where an attacker continuously sends the last known update, even if newer updates are available. On the middle right, we have what's known as an endless data attack, where an attacker attempts to crash a device by sending it an indefinite amount of data, making it run out of storage space. Uptane also aims to guard against an arbitrary software attack, where an attack aims to overwrite the software on the device using their own malicious software. There are many more types of attacks that Uptane aims to guard against beyond what we have shown here, demonstrating its comprehensive capabilities. Uptane is itself based on what's known as the Update Framework, or TUF for short. TUF secures updates by associating different pieces of metadata with each update, and the metadata itself must be secure. TUF has four key principles. First, it separates certain duties associated with the backend during the update process. Each element in the backend generates certain metadata. Second, it uses multi-trust signatures, where metadata must be signed by a minimum number of backend elements or parties. Third, TUF supports explicitly or implicitly revoking keys. Implicit revocation can occur by having expiry dates on keys, and explicit revocation can occur by signing new metadata that replaces old keys with new keys. Finally, TUF also uses offline keys, which are air-gapped from the internet, so that the most sensitive metadata cannot be signed, even if the repository is compromised. Thus, before the device even begins to download the update itself, it first downloads and verifies metadata signed by usually four distinct roles used in TUF. Here we can see the four general roles that exist in TUF. First, we have the root, which serves as a certificate authority for the repository. It is responsible for distributing and revoking any public keys used to verify itself and the other three roles. Then we have the timestamp role, which is meant to indicate if any new metadata or update is available. Third, we have the snapshot role, which notifies devices the available updates at the time defined by the metadata signed by the timestamp role. Finally, we have the target role, which provides metadata associated with the update itself, such as hashes and/or file sizes. It is important to remember that metadata generated and signed by each of these roles is verified by the device before the device performs an update. Just as another FYI, if you're interested in reading more detailed literature about Uptane, a common term associated is SOTA, or Secure Over the Air. Finally, as mentioned previously, Uptain distributes the different components that are responsible for signing metadata in the backend across different compute elements. This inherently forces an attacker to compromise many different systems. If a single component is compromised, the device can identify the metadata that is anomalous and outright reject the update entirely. In addition to security, reliability is also a critical requirement when performing OTA. One framework that offers reliability is OS Tree. It is a Git-like file system where each file is tracked as an object, similar to Git. Entire file system trees can be tracked on a per-file basis, and different trees are kept as references, also similar to Git branches. A user can make changes to the file system and commit them. Conversely, an entire file system can be checked out at a particular commit point. OS Tree is designed such that updates are atomic. This means that if an update is interrupted, OS Tree will revert the entire file system back to the previous state. This can happen if the system crashes or if there is a power loss. OS Tree references the underlying inode as a simple hard link. Thus, whenever an update is applied, only the link needs to be updated, making it quick when compared to doing actual file operations and transactions. Here are some details on OS Tree and how it works. On each boot, a unique staging directory is created. If an update is available, objects that refer to files are stored in the staging directory. And after an object is written, a call to fsync is made to ensure that the objects are written. In the case of a power loss, the previous directory is invalidated. Again, on a boot, an entirely new directory is created. Although this can be overkill, this serves as the crux of the inherent atomic nature of OS Tree, which gives it its reliability. Finally, after all of the objects are retrieved, the existing hard links are updated to point to the new files. Again, as mentioned, updating hard links is a much quicker operation than any sort of actual file operations, which retains the atomicity of this process. This diagram just shows how the hard links are migrated. Again, this is done on a file-by-file basis, and the hard link update process is also atomic. Thus, if power is lost at this stage, the existing hard links are maintained, and OS Tree can pick up where it left off on the next boot cycle. Whenever an OTA operation is being performed, we have to be cognizant of any downtime that may manifest and characterize it accordingly. For example, in the case of OS Tree, while retrieving the objects locally is not going to affect the normal operation of the device, switching the hard links may. For example, services may need to be gracefully shut down before the hard links are transitioned. Thus, we need to characterize the times and intervals when a device will be inoperable during an OTA session. A mechanism is needed that can allow fleet managers to define these intervals. They can identify when a device is least used and schedule updates at that time. They can also define static downtimes to notify customers or end users windows when the device may be inoperable. These are referred to as maintenance windows. In these time intervals, the device can be configured to check for an update at particular intervals, which may be more often than regular operational times, and then perform the actual update. Another important feature that needs to exist in an Edge or IoT network is remote access and monitoring. We all know that it's not a question of if things will go wrong, but when, and we need to plan for them. Also, we need to remember that there are degrees of failure. The first is performance. For example, let's say a corner case was met in the field by a device which ultimately manifested in a bug which resulted in increased resource utilization. Another degree, which is more catastrophic, is functional. In this case, there is something fundamentally wrong with the implementation that is preventing it from working. In both cases, a need for remote access and monitoring is necessary to not only detect issues before they become catastrophic, but to allow an engineer to intervene when catastrophic events do happen all of a sudden. In the case of performance issues, for example, we would want to monitor key metrics of resource utilization, such as CPU and RAM. In this case, we would want to identify issues before they become catastrophic. For example, we would want to catch a memory leak before it hogs all the system RAM. In the case of functional issues, we would want only an authorized engineer to access the system. They could view and download logs as needed and put temporary stopgaps in place until a more permanent solution is available. Another key feature that we have failed to mention is offline updates. You must be thinking to yourself that isn't an offline OTA update an oxymoron? How can you have an over-the-air update when the device is offline? Well, offline updates are meant to handle scenarios where the device doesn't have internet connectivity. We would still need a mechanism to support local updates, for example, via USB flash drive. Again, it is critical that this mechanism also only allow for authorized updates, even over USB. Otherwise, if physical connections are ignored, an attacker can bypass all of the measures that are in place for OTA updates with a simple flash drive. Torizon addresses the requirements that we just mentioned and incorporates the frameworks that were listed. Security and reliability is achieved by using Uptane and OS Tree. As a matter of fact, Actualizer is the framework that is used on the device that serves as a SOTA client for Uptane, and it uses OS Tree to manage file system revisions. Torizon also supports remote monitoring, which we will see in the demo. As a note, remote access is a feature that will be coming soon, and we will discuss in more detail in an upcoming webinar. Maintenance windows are also supported, where polling frequencies and update time intervals can be defined on the device. Torizon will also support offline updates in a future release. It also supports device provisioning and fleet management so that devices can be organized into different groups. Relevant updates for a device are identified by the metadata associated with the device and the hardware itself. Let's quickly recap the demos from the previous webinar, since we will be building on top of them. First, we created a custom Torizon Core OS image where we added a device tree overlay to support an SHT31 environmental sensor on the appropriate I2C bus. We used Torizon Core Builder to make changes to the device tree and push it to the Verdant IMX8M mini SOM with a Dahlia carrier board, which was on the local network. Then, we created two custom Docker containers and a multi-container application. One container read data from the SHT31 sensor and stored it in an InfluxDB database. Another container retrieved data from the InfluxDB database and presented it on a web interface using Flask in Python. We transferred the application using SCP and ran it on the device using the command line interface. The steps from the previous webinar are not scalable. Although they are fine for development, they can't be used to easily deploy the application on multiple devices. In the upcoming slides, we're going to demonstrate the steps that we can use to create custom OS images and container applications that can then be easily pushed onto the appropriate devices. In just a few moments, we will be demonstrating with the same Verdant IMX8M mini SOM and Dahlia carrier board, along with an Apalis IMX8M quad with an Ixera carrier board. We will be creating two sets of packages and uploading them to the Torizon web interface. The first will be a custom Torizon Core OS image. Since each device requires a custom device tree change, since the I2C bus numbering is different, we will create two OS images. Second, because of a deficiency in the Docker container implementation, we will need to create a set of Docker applications. Ideally, we would want to update the Docker container so that a single application can be used on both devices. Finally, once the packages are created and pushed up to the web interface, we can simply push them onto the relevant device and confirm functionality. The process is as follows. First, we're going to start from scratch. We're going to load the standard Torizon Core OS image on each device. We are then going to provision the device. Finally, we're going to push our custom Torizon Core OS image onto the device, and we'll test to make sure we can communicate with the SHT31 environmental sensor. Finally, we're going to push the Docker application onto our device and confirm that we can view the environmental data on the web interface as we had done in the past. We're going to switch things around a little bit. Instead of creating the custom Torizon Core OS image first, we're going to be creating the individual Docker containers. The reason for doing this is because we already have the board set up with the two Docker containers already configured. And so we can reuse those and push them up to the Docker Hub for later use in the Docker Compose file. Because imagine, the Docker Compose file is going to be the basis for the container application on our individual devices that are deployed. And so we need a central location for the Docker Compose file to be able to pull the Docker containers from. Whereas previously we actually built the containers on the device itself, now Torizon needs a mechanism to be able to download the containers and pull them together for our final application. And we'll be using Docker Hub for that purpose. So first, we're going to go to Docker Hub and we see we've created three repositories to hold our containers. The first is the InfluxDB environmental sensor Docker container for our Apalis board. The other is the SHT31 InfluxDB container for the Verdon board. And then the finally, which is a single container for both boards, is the Flask. The reason, as we mentioned previously, for creating two separate containers for the two different boards is because the environmental sensor appears in SysFS as a different hardware monitor entry between the Palace SOM and the Verdon SOM. And so we needed to be able to distinguish them accordingly. Ideally, if we create a Python application that is able to automatically determine which entry in SysFS the environmental sensor exists, we wouldn't need two containers. We can use a single container. So now that we have the repository created, we're actually going to go to the board itself to be able to create the containers. So the reason for doing this is because when we go to actually build the container, Docker actually goes through the Docker file and builds up the container. So because we can't necessarily do that easily on an x86 PC, we're going to be doing that on the native ARM board that we have. So to quickly do that, right here we have the base environmental sensor Docker Compose application, the multi-Docker container application that we have from previously. So we're going to go into the InfluxDB application, and here is one container that we have. So we're simply going to build this, and then this is the format that we have for building the Verdon InfluxDB environmental sensor container. We're just going to run this command. And since we've already pre-built this, because it already exists, we've completed this step pretty quickly. If we did it from scratch, Docker would go through the process of building the container and then tagging it as an image. And now all we need to do is just push this container up to Docker Hub, right? And again, because we haven't made any differences or any changes to the container since the last time we've done this, since I've done this previously, this process also runs pretty quickly. And then if we go up a few levels into, so we created a separate directory for the container for the Apalis board, right? So in here, the only thing that's different is we've just changed the directory where this is read in the Verdon SOM, in the Verdon application. This is hardware monitor 2. In the Apalis application, in the application for the Apalis SOM, this is hardware monitor 1. So in this case, we're going to run the same application again. We're going to build an image, and we're just going to call it. And again, because we've already built this and this Docker image exists in our local repository, Docker doesn't need to do anything. And now we just need to push this up again. Okay, and again, because I've already done this step previously, this already exists. This step is pretty quick because the container already exists in Docker Hub. And then similarly, we can do the same for the Flask app. So this is going to be Flask. And here we can see Yep. So Docker is going through the process of actually creating this container. And I think that's probably because I haven't actually built this container on this device. Okay. And so so now if we push this up, and just as a quick verification that our Docker containers have been pushed up, okay, we've actually just created a single Docker Compose file that references our container images up on Docker Hub, right? So here we have the SHT31 InfluxDB for the Verdin container image, and then this is for the Flask. So in this case, so this would just kind of verify that our containers have been correctly pushed up onto Docker Hub, and if we have a single compose file in really any board, right, that Docker would be able to successfully pull down these containers and execute them and bring them up on our board itself. So if we just do Docker compose up, and again, because we've already done this as a previous step, Docker doesn't actually need to pull down the container from Hub because it already has them stored locally. And all it needs to do is just bring up the containers and then bring up the multi-container application. Okay. And then if we go to the IP address, it's this one, right? We can see that our container, our multi-Docker container application is running, right? And all we did is just bring up the compose file. Okay. So now that we've pushed up the containers up to Docker Hub, and we know that we can run a Docker Compose file correctly, we're now going to go to the next step, which would really be the first step in creating and pushing our Torizon Core OS image. Next, we're going to show a demo that illustrates how we can create a custom Torizon Core OS image that supports an SHT31 environmental sensor, push it up to the OTA web interface, and then using the web interface, push it down onto the device and confirm functionality. First, we're going to start off from scratch by using a standard Torizon Core OS image that has been loaded on a Verdin IMX8M mini SOM with a Dahlia carrier board. We're then going to create and push a custom Torizon Core OS image onto the web interface that supports the SHT31 sensor. Third, we're going to provision a device using the instructions provided to us by the OTA web interface. Then we're going to push the custom OS, the custom Torizon Core OS image onto the device using the web interface. Finally, we're going to confirm functionality on the device itself and validate that we can communicate with the SHT31 environmental sensor. To get started, we're going to first confirm that we have a standard Torizon Core OS image on our Verdin board. To do that, we're going to SSH into the board. And if you recall from the last webinar, the way we verified that we could communicate with the SHT31 environmental sensor and our configuration was correct was that an entry in SysFS appeared as a hardware monitor, right? So previously, before we added support for the SHT31 environmental sensor, we had two hardware monitors. And when we added support for the environmental sensor, we had a third one. So here we can see we still only have two, which is an indication that we haven't added support for the SHD31 sensor yet. We can also confirm by querying the name entry for each of these hardware monitor devices. So if we look at hardware monitor 0 and hardware monitor 1, we can see that neither is indeed the SHD31 sensor. Okay. So the next step is we're going to create the actual custom Torizon Cur OS image with support for the SHD31 environmental sensor. So the way we do that first is we're going to source the environment, the script that sets up the environment for us. Don't want to check for any updates. We're good to go. The next step is we're going to unpack the baseline burden IMX8 mini Torizon image. This is telling us that since we've already done this step offline, we already have this image loaded and we need to replace it. Now that we've unpacked the image, we're going to apply the device tree change to the device tree blob that corresponds to this board. And we're going to check the status to make sure that the overlay was applied to the device tree. Finally, we're going to commit the change into this particular branch. And then the last step, which we didn't do previously, so up to here, everything that we've done, we've also done in the previous webinar. The last step to allow us to push the customized image to the OTA web interface is we're going to sign it and then push it up. So before we sign the image, we have to go to the web interface and download the credentials. So if we click on this button, that will allow us to download the credentials that we will be using to sign our images that we push up. So we've already done this previously, and we can see that the zip file that contains our credentials is right here. So to push this new build onto the web interface, onto the web server, we're going to execute the Torizon Core Builder command with the push argument, and then the option to set the credentials to the zip file, along with the branch that we want to commit, that we want to push up. So this process takes a fair bit of time, right? And then the first thing that we're going to want to do is, so now we need to actually provision the device. So what we're going to do is we're going to go to the web interface. We're going to click on provision device. We're just going to copy this command, go to our device, execute this command, allow it to run, and now we should see the device has appeared. Okay. Now, before we also push up the custom image, the custom OS image to the device, one of the things that we want to do is increase the polling frequency. So by default, the actualizer SOTA OTA, it's the SOTA client, the Optane client that Torizon uses, has a standard polling frequency of every 5 minutes. So when we push up the image and then instruct the device to initiate an update, it's actually going to take 5 minutes before the device actually is querying the web server for any updates and then proceeds to download it. So to make that process a bit quicker, we're going to change that frequency or that polling interval to 30 seconds. And to do that, first we're going to stop the actualizer service. we need to do this as sudo. And then we're going to make a directory that in slash etsy that corresponds to the sodo configuration. And then we're going to copy the standard sodo configuration that we can't modify. That we can't modify to the directory that we just created in Etsy. Remember, this user lib soda config.d directory is actually a reference from OSTree, and ultimately this becomes a hard link to slash Etsy soda conf.d. And what we're doing is we're just copying that file over and modifying the entry in Etsy to change this value to 30 seconds, okay? And now if we open up another terminal and we look at what actual the log files corresponding to the actualizer service, and we start actualizer, we can see that for the polling interval, it actually read the file that we specified in slash etsy, whereas with previous config files, it actually read it from the standard user lib directory, okay? So now that we have that, and we can see that the package, the custom OS tree, the custom Torizon Core OS image has been signed and pushed up to our device. And we can see that. Click on refresh, right? And we can see that this has appeared. So now to initiate an actual update, I'm going to click on this green box. I'm going to click on this. And we're going to initiate the process. So now we just have to wait for actualizer to go ahead and query for the device. And we can see that it already went and started the process. It identified that an update is available and already went ahead and it's in the process of updating. And we just have to wait for the update process to finish. All right. And so we can see that the update was successful. And if we log back in to the device, we can see that a third entry has appeared. And if we look at the name, we can see that this is actually the SHT31 sensor now, okay? The next step is to formulate and push up the Docker Compose file up to the OTA server, initiate the update of the device with the Docker Compose file, allow the device to update itself, and then confirm functionality. So before we do that, we need to first make sure that the device, again, we have to go through the same process of making sure that the polling frequency is set to, right, it's set to 30 seconds, right? And we can confirm that first. Because there's always a concern when you do an update whether which files in the RFS get updated. So we just want to confirm that the frequency, the polling interval is set to 30 seconds, right? So we don't just sit here waiting for the device to initiate an update, okay? So now we previously tested and created a Docker Compose file that we see here, right? And this has the names of the containers that we want this multi-Docker, multi-container Docker application to use. So we have the SHT31 InfluxDB in addition to the Flask app that interfaces with the InfluxDB itself and presents the data on a web interface. So to push this package up, all we need to do is add a package, Docker Compose, attach the file, continue. Right, and now this Docker Compose file has been added has been added to our list of packages that are available to update devices. So now we're going to select, we're going to update the device with this Docker Compose file. We select the YAML file, hit continue, finish. And again, it's queuing, so we have to wait for the device to actually go ahead and initiate the update on its side. Right, so now the device is actually queried again because we set the polling frequency to 30 seconds. It doesn't have to wait long. Typically, this default setting is 5 minutes. And again, depending on your power consumption requirements, you and depending on how often and what time intervals you want updates to happen, this is very configurable, right? This has a lot of options and knobs that you can adjust to make sure that the device updates itself or starts to begin the update process at certain time intervals that you think that you've determined that makes sense for your device and your system and your network. And then if we go back to the log file, okay, so now we can actually see that the update is complete and the actualizer service is going ahead and starting the Docker Compose file and bringing it up. And we can see that the update is complete, right? So now if we go ahead and go to the web interface, we can see that without having to do anything on the command line, that we have our Docker application up and running, right? And so all we had to do was push that compose file to our OTA web server and initiate the update on the device. Basically assigned that package to the device. The device went and queried the backend to see if there was any relevant update for itself, and it began the update process. Next, we want to run through the same steps as we did with the Verdant SOM and Dahlia board with the Apollo SOM and Ixer board. We've already done this because it's basically the same steps that we're doing, and it really doesn't make sense to go through them again. I mean, the only differences that existed are the device tree change, because again, the I2C bus was different on the Apollo SOM as it was on the Verdant SOM, and the Docker Compose file, because whereas the Verdant SOM had three hardware monitor devices, and then the SHT31 environmental sensor was the third one, the Apollo SOM actually only had one hardware monitor entry into SysFS, and then the SHT31 added a second one. So that's why we needed to, because in our Python application, we basically hard code the file that we read for the hardware, for the temperature and humidity information. That's why we need to do it. That's why we needed to have separate Docker Compose files, because we needed separate Docker containers. Ideally, we would want to implement our Python application in such a way where it's independent of what the entry is in SysFS, right? Because the kernel can create however it wants to the entries in SysFS that correspond to these environmental sensors, and there really is no guarantee that that they will appear in order as we want them to, right? So ideally, we would implement the Python application to make it more flexible. And then we would only need to use a single Docker compose file because we would have a single Docker container that interfaces with the environmental sensor. One thing that I wanted to actually show you that's interesting and that's exciting about the web interface, the Torizon OTA web interface, is that if we, you can see here that we've already pre-provisioned the device, we've added the custom Torizon Cur OS, and with the Docker the Docker compose file, right? And that's why we're able to access the environmental data on the Apalis board. But the exciting thing that I wanted to show you is that if we go to actually do an update and select on the custom OS, Torizon is clever enough to know, again, because metadata is associated with the with each image that specifies what hardware this image corresponds to, that if we go to the dropdown, Torizon is smart enough to tell us, to only allow us to restrict OS images that are meant for the Apalis hardware. We can't choose the Verdin Core OS image that we've created previously. And similarly, if we go to the Verdin board, we can only see the OS image that corresponds to the Verdin board. So I just wanted to kind of mention that and show that, okay, now we have two devices with ultimately identical applications that present humidity and temperature on a web interface. The last thing that we want to show and demonstrate are fleets in the Torizon OTA web server. This allows us to create fleets, assign devices to fleets, and then update software on all devices in a fleet, as opposed to individual devices themselves. So here we can see all the fleets that are available if we click on the fleet manager, and we can see here that we've created two sets of fleets, one that corresponds to one organization and another that corresponds to another organization. So this could potentially represent either a development team or a test team, or a development team, a test team and the actual deployment team, right? So these would correspond to either devices that the developers have, and this corresponds to devices that the test team has. And then you can have a third organization that corresponds to devices that are actually out in the field. So developers would update, the development manager would update all devices on that correspond to the fleet for developers. And then once that's been thoroughly tested by the development team, that software package can be pushed to devices that correspond to the test team. And then the third organization that corresponds to once the test manager has approved the image, the software image, based on the results of the test team, that can be pushed down to another organization that corresponds to devices that are actually deployed out in the field. We can add devices onto the fleet. So we just need to click on it and it gets added to the fleet. And then all we need to do if we wanted to potentially update all devices in the fleet is just clicking on the appropriate application, and then it would go ahead and update all devices in the fleet. Okay, so that's the power that Torizon offers, in that you can organize devices based on your own human organization of how developers, test engineers, devices that are deployed out in the field are organized, and then you can sequentially update devices in an organized fashion so that you can go through the entire software development life cycle. To summarize, we demonstrated how the Torizon web interface streamlines device deployment. We created a custom Torizon Core OS image that interfaces with the custom peripheral, specifically the SHD31 environmental sensor. We also created a custom multi-container Docker application that leverages this custom peripheral in a specific application. We then showed the seamless update mechanism that Torizon offers through its innovative web interface, and how we have fine-grained control of certain update parameters on the device itself that allows us to balance and manage certain device parameters such as downtime and power consumption against the OTA update frequency. We also demonstrated the concept of fleets, where devices can be organized based on their use case. It allows organizations to follow the software development lifecycle. Thank you for attending this webinar. We hope that you found it useful and insightful, and hope that you also leverage Torizon's powerful features to streamline and seamlessly manage and update IoT and Edge devices in your own networks. We will now be transitioning to the Q&A session.
All right, thank you, everybody. We're now going to transition to the Q&A session. So we do have a few questions. And yep, the first question that we have is, can you clarify how OS Tree can guarantee atomic updates? So in general, the way OS Tree works is it operates on a file by file basis. So it receives a patch for each file and a corresponding signature for the entire update. And as each file is updated, an fsync is performed on that file to make sure that the file has been committed to disk, has been persisted, and then it moves on to the next file. And on each boot, a new temporary directory is created that contains all of these updates. And then so it goes file by file to make sure that the update has been applied. And then, like I said, it performs an fsync. And then once the entire once all of the files have been updated, the hard links are moved from the file from the actual file system to point to the updated files. And once that entire process is complete, a flag is set that basically lets OS Tree know that this is the new tree that should be used for when on next restarts. So that's generally how OS Tree guarantees atomic updates. Drew, do you have any additional comments or details that you want to add?
Yeah, are you hearing me okay? Is my mic working?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, good. Yeah, I mean, the only thing I would add is to stress the point that it's the atomicity is guaranteed by that very final change of a single symlink to point to the new boot file system. So, you know, everything happens in OS Tree in the repository. Like you say, all those new files are added and they're verified and everything, and they're never used until that very final symlink is changed. And that symlink is a single atomic operation. So that's really ultimately what controls the update to a new version and guarantees that it's atomic.
Cool. Next question is, how does Torizon handle maintenance windows? How can my application control that? So we did see one example of maintenance windows by setting the polling frequency. So and there are other options too that not only set the polling frequency, but also the actual time windows that the device actually queries to the backend to see if there are any updates. And in terms of like the application itself, you could, on a device by device basis, you could set these particular parameters individually. Drew, do you have any additional comments?
Yeah, there's also a lock file that Actualizer respects. So if your application creates a lock file and creates a specific file in a location on the disk and then uses the flock kernel API to actually lock that file, then that will block Actualizer from doing anything. So for your, you know, maintenance windows or your device in operation do not update methodology, there's a single lock file. We are developing additional functionality allowing you to get more information about the update, so you can then post a UI dialogue to your end users and say, hey, you know, update 3 is available. This is highly critical. You should update now or whatever. We don't know what all the details and workflows are going to be supported for that, but we do want to allow more fine-grained control of that update process so you can plug it into your application as needed.
Cool. Thank you for that. Next question is, can I have a device that does both online and offline updates? So Toradex has recently released or is about to release a webinar was actually presented yesterday regarding secure offline updates. And I believe, and correct me if I'm wrong, Drew, that on a device by device basis, it like you would have to physically go in and make changes to support either offline or online updates. Like it can't be done simultaneously. Is that correct?
In this first release of the secure offline updates, yes, that's correct. But that's a feature we will hopefully be adding shortly is the ability to do, you know, some online updates and some offline. But we just didn't want to complicate this first release with that.
Got it. Makes sense. And also just to kind of provide some detail on offline updates. And again, you can check out the webinar. We can post a link in the chat window for the webinar, or whenever recording is available, you can sign up for our mailing list. Generally, it's the cool thing about the offline update. It again leverages the same sort of security and reliability that the online update uses. There's a concept of a lockbox that's created. And again, that provides the security to make sure that only the provisioned device for which that update has been created is the one that accepts that particular update. Is that correct, Drew? That's from.
Yeah. It's basically a way to take all the security of the obtained system with all the metadata signatures and verifications and apply it to a device that may not be connected at any given time.
Cool. Next question that we have is, can you elaborate on the difference between Uptain and TUF? So from my understanding, TUF is really a framework and Uptain is an implementation of that framework. Now, Uptain also does provide additional features that the framework itself doesn't necessarily provide guidance on. But for me, the simplest way that I think about it is that TUF itself is just a framework, and then Uptain is the implementation that goes along with it. What are your thoughts on that, Drew?
Well, I think TUF was an earlier attempt at this. Uptain basically took TUF and, from what I understand, does it twice somehow. I don't know all the details, but Uptain is obviously targeted towards the automotive space, so it protects against additional attack scenarios that TUF itself can't necessarily protect against. If you are interested in that, there are lots of good YouTube resources and web resources on the details of Uptain and TUF by the people that designed them. So I'm certainly not an expert in those, and I would encourage you, if you really want to dig into that, to check out some of those online resources, because the researchers put a lot of time and effort into it, and they're obviously the experts on it.
Cool. Thanks for that. And the last question that we have is, and this is more for Drew. I know that Toradex is working on the remote access feature for an upcoming iteration of Torizon. Can you briefly describe how you think, or what the planning is for how that will work, or how the user would potentially interface, or engineers would interface with that feature?
Yeah, I don't have a whole lot of details to give on that. It is an active design as we speak. My guess is it's going to be, it's not going to be direct SSH access to each individual board. My guess is it's going to be kind of an in-band communication that's in that's tunneled through the existing transport between the device and the server, but I don't know that for complete fact at the moment. But and presumably there will be API access to it as well. So from a command line, you could probably just directly access the boards as if you were SSHing into them, even if it's not actual SSH.
Right. So I guess something similar to a lot of what the cloud vendors offer in terms of a CLI, where you can kind of do API accesses. I imagine that would be pretty cool.
Yeah, that would be my best guess. But I'm not the one designing it, so they may have different use cases that I'm unaware of.
Cool. Sounds good. So that's all the questions that we have from the that we have populated from the questions box. All right. Doesn't seem like anybody has any questions. Again, we thank everybody so much for attending this webinar. We hope you found it really insightful on how Torizon can really streamline the process of managing your IoT and Edge devices. We hope that you do consider Torizon as the platform, because it is a comprehensive platform that can allow you to not only manage and customize the applications that are on your device, what we've seen in the last two webinars on how it can give you control over really the entire OS at multiple levels of detail. So Drew, do you wanna leave us with any final words of wisdom?
Nothing specific. Just want to thank everybody for their time. We know your time is valuable, so we do appreciate you coming to learn about Torizon. You know, if you have any questions, reach out. Community.toradex.com is our community forum site. That's the best place to go, ask questions, get support. Myself and several of my colleagues are tasked with monitoring that site, so you get pretty good time zone coverage. So if you have any questions, you know, reach out to us on our community site, and we'll do our best to answer.
Cool. All right. Thank you, everybody, for attending. Right. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Bye now.
Bye.